Welcome to Maine Arts Magazine. My name is Ed Morin. With me is Judy Sobol, director of the Joan Whitney Payson Gallery of Art at Westbrook College in Portland.
March 21st was the 300th anniversary of the birth of Johann Sebastian Bach. An important contribution to the celebration is a recording released March 10th of Bach's Art of the Fugue. The album was released on arabesque and recorded by the Portland String Quartet.
It's ideally suited for the quartet and it just seems to flow. And that's exactly what fugue means, really. Fugue means literally a flight of fancy.
The Fugue is a collection of 14 fugues that were written by Bach as a culmination of his life's work, really. He never did finish it, died before completing the 14th fugue. Many historians believe that it was originally written as a treatise on fugal writing, which was one of Bach's main passions, really, and the thing probably that he was most proficient at.
There's an 11-note theme, and to be able to come up with what amounts to 80 minutes worth of incredible music based on 11 notes is almost beyond comprehension. To be able to do that, one has to be able to find the ideal theme, something that is suitable, something that is accessible. And the wonderful thing about the work is that despite the fact that at least superficially, it can be looked at very much as an academic exercise in music. It is not that at all. It ends up being an extremely emotional experience, probably highlighted by the fact that Bach never finished it. When one gets the end of the work, it's astounding. No matter how many times we've played it, you can't end up with dry eyes.
One interesting aspect of the Art of the Fugue is that Bach didn't indicate the instruments he had in mind for the work.
This particular work is unbelievably successful with string quartet. The sustaining ability that a quartet has, the singing ability and the ability to sustain, really suits the work magnificently. And one almost has to, it's hard to believe that he wouldn't have had possibly that in mind. Of course, there's no way to prove it. But it's nice to say it anyhow. Mm-hmm.
No matter what instruments Bach wrote his monumental work for, the Portland String Quartet's arabesque recording of The Art of the Fugue is the first recording of the complete composition by a string quartet.
What do Julian Bream, the Vienna choir boys, Isaac Stern, and Jean-Pierre Rampal have in common? Well, the Portland Concert Association brought the choir boys and Julian Bream to Maine this season. Next season, they're bringing Isaac Stern and Jean-Pierre Rampal. The Portland Concert Association is hoping that a difference between this year and next will be a dramatic increase in subscription sales.
When you work for the Portland Concert Association, concert day is a hectic one. Performers like the Berlin Radio Symphony Orchestra have to be accommodated. Audiences have to be accommodated. You pray it doesn't snow. This year, more than others, the association has hoped for clear skies on concert days because subscription sales have been down and single ticket sales haven't always been able to make up the difference. David Nicholas is president of the Portland Concert Association.
It's touch and go, though. Yeah. This may be the first season in 10 years that the Concert Association will have a deficit for the current year operations. We hope to counter that tendency by our offerings for next year, which we are ready at this time to announce. We're hoping that people will realize that with the offerings that we are providing, that a subscription is going to be necessary if they're going to hear some of the events which we will be bringing.
For many years, the Portland Concert Association brought performers to town as part of the community concert organization run by Columbia Artist Management. To get better acts into Portland, PCA went off on its own in 1977.
Since then, we have expanded the number of offerings that we have from, at that time, 4 per year to this year's 13. And we also, in that first year, in that split, offered single ticket sales in addition to subscription sales. Also, one other aspect which has become very important for the association since the break with community concerts has been a residency program, which we started in that first year with one event, and this year we're sponsoring 3 events in the neighborhood schools and with area music educators.
Is there any type of endowment or supplemental support that is involved with your season, or do you have to make it go on the price of a ticket?
We do look to funding from not only the Maine State Commission on the Arts and Humanities, but the National Endowment for the Arts as well, especially for the residency programs. And we're looking more and more to more community support from individuals and businesses as far as that's concerned to help us with this, you know, the residency programs especially.
I think that ticket sales must support the major portion of our budget. If it turns out that people are unwilling to come to hear the likes of an Isaac Stern or a James Galway or the Boston Symphony Orchestra or some of the events that by any stretch of the imagination should sell on their own, then I think the organization has to reconsider what it's doing. We have found that even in this year in which we believe we may have a deficit, that certain programs have proven to be very popular. It's very difficult to determine which ones are going to sell and which aren't until almost the day before the concert.
Concert has 2 more performances scheduled this year, the Palabolas Dance Theater and well-known pianist Murray Pariah. Next year, as we said, Isaac Stern and Jean-Pierre Rampal will be in Maine, along with organizations like the Academy of Ancient Music, the Royal Winnipeg Ballet, the Chieftains, and others you can find out about by contacting the Portland Concert Association.
Next on Maine Arts Magazine, we travel to Rockland for a visit to our featured gallery, the William A. Farnsworth Library and Art Museum. William A. Farnsworth was a good example of a successful 19th century capitalist. Profits he made from enterprises in such things as limestone, gas, and water enabled him to live in a pretty lavish Victorian style. Marius Pelladeau is director of the William A. Farnsworth Library and Art Museum.
And did quite well. The only unfortunate thing is he died rather young and left the business to his son, the only male heir, who carried it on, but his son James died again with no son. So it was Lucy Farnsworth, the last daughter, who decided that the Farnsworth name should not die out in Rockland and left the money in trust to found this museum.
The building opened in 1948. Lucy had intended her gift to be a library in which paintings could be hung. Then Andrew Carnegie gave Rockland a library.
And the trustee asked the probate court if the will could be changed to play up on those words, "and paintings may be hung," to give Rockland something which it did not have, an art gallery, an art museum, since it already had a library. But our corporate title is still the William A. Farnsworth Library first and Art Museum, because this beautiful room in which we're sitting now was designed specifically to meet the conditions of Lucy's will that we have a library room. It is primarily now an art reference library, open to the public. We get good use, especially during school vacations when UMO or Bowdoin or Bates students are home for the vacations doing term papers. We don't pretend to be comprehensive, but it's a good library for the size of the building and the space.
Inside the Farnsworth are five gallery spaces. Two are used for changing exhibitions like this show of photographs by Berenice Abbott. Three of the Farnsworth's exhibition spaces are for the museum's permanent collection.
The museum has very few funds with which to buy paintings. So most of our accessions come by gift, and we've had some very kind and generous members over the past 30 plus years who have given us works of art as a repository to keep it here in Maine. And we're very proud that though our collection is not Maine alone, we do have a strong focus on how Maine has influenced American art. Because the gifts have been so numerous, we felt that we should thank those who have given to us, and the only way we can do that is to display the paintings or sculpture that they have donated to the museum. And so a couple years ago, we took two spaces down on the lower level, which were not being used for full capacity, and changed them into galleries for the permanent collection, so we can show our Winslow Homers and Gilbert Stuarts and paintings of that quality. Andrew Wyeth, of course, is a drawing card, the whole Wyeth family in the summertime, but we have William Zorak, Edward Hopper, George Bellows. In fact, one of our most popular shows in recent years was a Monhegan show of all the famous artists who have come to Monhegan Island. Of course, the other gem of the collection is the Farnsworth Homestead, which is next door, and you can see out through the window. That was the Farnsworth Homestead, and part of Lucy's will placed quite a bit of emphasis on what she wanted done with the house. She wanted it preserved exactly as it was when she lived in it, which is why it's on the National Register of Historic Places, and considered an extremely beautiful example of how a lime merchant, a lumber baron in Bangor, or how the well-to-do in Maine lived at the middle of the 19th century.
And our curator, Mary, while the Farnsworth Homestead is open from May to October, the art museum itself is open year-round and maintains a busy exhibition schedule.
This summer, actually, we'll be opening our major spring exhibition in May. Will be Will Barnett, very interesting American artist who did quite a bit of his work right here in Maine. He's a very exciting artist. He works on very, very large canvases, and we'll actually have a selection of his works from his early days, including some pencil sketches, etchings, some lithographs, And then his very, very large oils on canvas. Then he'll be followed by Alex Katz, which opens up in July. Another very interesting American artist who also works right here in Maine, has a studio right down the road in Lincolnville. Again, works on very, very large canvases. Both of those exhibitions will be in the Maine Gallery and in the Hadlock Gallery.
Mm-hmm. Certainly an impressive list of names. Paintings from the Farnsworth collection are often loaned to other galleries throughout the state for various exhibitions. The William A. Farnsworth Library and Art Museum is a valuable resource for the city of Rockland and the entire state of Maine.
The Portland Museum of Art has an exhibition up now you may want to see. Marston Hartley was a pioneer of modern art in America. He was born in Lewiston, Maine in 1877. The paintings in this exhibition are from the I. Owen and Hudson D. Walker collection and were selected from the collection of the University of Minnesota Art Museum. The show is on a two-year tour across the United States under the auspices of the Art Museum Association of America. Works by Marston Hartley will be on display through May 5th at the Portland Museum of Art. Let's look at some other arts events happening in the state of Maine during the next month. Complex, multifaceted, conceptually consistent. Words which can describe an artist we'd like to introduce you to on Maine Arts Magazine.
Roger Richmond is a glass artist and owner of Portland's Sho-Shin Gallery. Richmond has been able to develop cutting techniques which allow him to use glass, much as a painter uses a palette. If Richmond's name sounds familiar, it may be because it's been in the news recently. The artist was selected from 75 nationwide to design Maine's Vietnam War Memorial. Construction on the memorial will begin as soon as project organizers raise the $250,000 needed for construction and maintenance of the work. Roger Richmond calls his art interactive.
You go to the Vietnam Memorial and it's standing out there and the sun is shining and the light is coming through this opening and it's casting this image on this back panel. And their shadow is interfering with the light of the soldiers, so that although if you choose to walk through this, you become involved, you become part of the composition instead of an observer.
Richmond's principles of interactive art have been a long time developing. As a young architecture student, he was able to interest NASA in hiring him to design interactive living environments for space missions, not from an engineering point of view, but from an architectural point of view.
And we said, no one's thought of this before. Come out and, you know, spend some time with us and design some humanistic, architecturally conceived space stations, moon ports, Mars flyby vehicles, zero gravity vehicles. Spend some time and do this. And that's exactly what I did. And one of the most incredible experiences of my life, because what I got to do was begin to formulate a new approach to architecture for myself, which was an architecture in what I called a hostile environment, which was any kind of environment that doesn't satisfy physical or psychological needs. And so I designed an environment, it's more of an event or a happening in space, that these people participated in the recreation of their own spaces so that there would be a change for them.
He says it's absolutely an experiment, but the glass artist is trying to use his interactive principles in a bust of a woman he calls Einstein's Lady.
And what it is that I have fragmented these three panels into three different images. One is just the hair of the woman, and the other one is one side of her face, and the third panel is the other side of her face. Now what this is that this is all going to be mounted into a structure that these panels can move. So you, Ed, can come up to this thing and look at it and say, well, and you can take one of these panels and slide it. And in that sliding, you become the artist. You're designing it in a way. Glass to me is the absolute best expression of space in painting or in watercolors or anything like this, that the opposite of black is white. But in glass, the opposite of black is clear.
Yeah.
So clear is a whole nother kind of dimension in terms of what you can experience. It's the void. It's the absolute void. What's there? Well, there's nothing there, but there's something there because there's nothing. I'm sorry. describing space, but to get a feeling for it, then you realize that the objects that you're producing and the spaces must marry together. In the Western world, we tend to look at the object and see that the space is that which separates objects. Mm-hmm. So we have an object here, and we have an object here, and this here is not, this is just what keeps these things apart. Now in the Eastern philosophy, they see this, these things is what keeps this together. Anything, quote, left over, unquote, in my work is a piece, is an object, it's a piece of glass. So I can't just draw an object and say, well, the background is what's left over. That just happens to be there. In glass, I have to cut that shape out. That's a thing, and I can pick up the space as a piece of glass, you know, in clear glass, and say, well, this is the space, and use it. And that is just a joy to see and be able to, you know, pick up a piece of clear glass and say, well, this is my space, you know, and walk away with it. So that's part of it.
Whether Richmond is walking away with a piece of space or a piece of glass which represents object, he must rely on a manufacturer for the colors he uses.
When I finish a piece and I think I know what the color looks like, and I went out and bought the glass that is the color that I want, and then I'll put it in the piece, and when I hold it up the first time, it might be slightly different. But that's not cause for alarm for me, because sometimes some of the most amazing relationships and new feelings have been created because the color was slightly different than what I really thought it was. So there's this, for me, it's the thing that maybe keeps me going in a long piece that might take 6 months to the end, that I know that in the end there's going to be, not only get to look at the piece, but maybe it's, I've never seen it. I've never really seen the piece until it's hanging up for the first time. Pinch it out. Am I gonna back up?
Oops.
Stick your hand right here and hold that in. Okay. Go ahead.
There it goes.
Yeah.
I want between you and the run and the swing around. So I'm trying to make sure there's anything.
Go ahead and pick up an inch or two and see what we got. Okay. Give it a little lift. You actually spun it the wrong way. That's okay.
Yeah, we sure did. Well.
I've never really seen the piece until it's hanging up for the first time.
As a glass artist, do you find sometimes that you are discriminated against? Because, after all, glass is a craftsman's game. It's not an artist's game. Do you get that feeling at all?
Yeah, sir.
How do you react
often,
to that feeling?
Often I will take, I'll take my work, let's say, to a gallery, and the gallery director or somebody will look at the work and say, this is magnificent, but we don't deal in glass. You know, we deal in this, or we deal in this, and that's perfectly okay, and I think that's fine. I mean, photography took photography such a long time before it finally began to be recognized as a really true and distinct art form. And I think, as in any art form, if the piece is done with subtlety, and it's done with care, because even painting is a craft. I mean, in its own way, not just the subject matter, but the application, the physical application of paint on a canvas involves technique, involves a certain sensitivity, feeling, and all these other qualities. Glass, although it is associated with a craft expression, can have a spiritual utility also. It can have the same kind of mood and subtlety and change and have an effect on the observer that a fine painting could.
And that's Maine Arts Magazine. Judy, thanks so much for letting us use the Payson Gallery for this month's show. Next month, we'll feature an exhibition here at the Payson Gallery, which is about
what it meant to be a woman pioneer in Maine art between 1900 and 1945.
And it runs
from the 9th of April through the 19th of May.
Sounds great. I'm Ed Morin.
And I'm Judy Sobel. We'll see you in 3 weeks with our next Maine Arts Magazine.
If you have comments or suggestions for our program, please write us. The address is Maine Arts Magazine, Post Office Box 1628, Portland, Maine, 04104.